So as I said at the outset, we are back today with a full day of programming, beginning now with our second showcase panel, this one on rules and standards and how they figured in Justice Scalia's jurisprudence and elsewhere. The question really is, when, if at all, should there be a preference for hard and fast rules, such as you've got to be some 18 years old to vote, for example, versus standards? Must someone be mature and experienced to vote? I'm here to welcome you, but also to introduce our moderator. Judge William Kuntz is fast becoming a Federalist Society veteran. He serves on the U.S. District Court for the Eastern District of New York. He's been on the bench there for over 5 years, after practicing law for over 30 years, and teaching law as well. He's one of the good ones, I can assure you. He is a friend of the society, and I'm very proud to know him, having met him for the first time in New York City some years ago. He also has, to my mind, a very varied background, but this is in his bio, which is available to you in the convention app, as is everyone else's bio, but a very interesting educational background, I think, which I've talked about before. In 1972, he got his bachelor's degree from Harvard College. He went on in 1974 to earn a master's degree from Harvard University. Then he got, in 1977, a JD from Harvard Law School, after which in 1979 he got a PhD from Harvard University. You see a pattern here. And I first met him in New York City. He very graciously took me to lunch at the Harvard Club, of course. With that, Judge Kuntz, please.
I thank you for that very gracious introduction. Don't worry, Professor Amar, when I introduce you in a few moments, I will, for the first and last time, utter the words Yale 4 times in a row. Without barnyard epithets preceding or following it. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is William Kuntz, and I am the United States District Court Judge from the Eastern District of New York, who has the honor and the privilege of moderating our panel of distinguished experts as they explore a central issue in modern constitutional and statutory interpretation: the tension between rules versus standards under our Constitution and in our statutes. Our first speaker is the Honorable Frank H. Easterbrook. He is a judge of the United States Court of Appeals for the Seventh Circuit. He is a senior lecturer at the Law School of the University of Chicago. He is one of the most well-known, respected, and admired jurists in our country, and he is now being introduced by the polar opposite jurist, Bill Kuntz from Brooklyn. He will be followed by Professor John C. Harrison, former law clerk to Judge Robert Bork of the United States Court of Appeals. The professor now serves as the James Madison Distinguished Professor of Law and Joseph C. Carter, Jr. Research Professor of Law at the University of Virginia Law School. He will be followed by Professor Akhil Reed Amar, the Sterling Professor of Law and Political Science at Yale University, where he teaches constitutional law at both Yale College and at the Yale Law School, and in 2008 received the Devane Medal, Yale's highest award for teaching excellence. Professor Amar will be followed by Professor Victoria Nurse. She is Professor of Law at the Georgetown University Law Center, where she is Director of the Georgetown Law Center on Congressional Studies. She clerked for Judge Edward Weinfeld, distinguished judge, as you all know, of the Southern District of New York, also known as the Mother Court to those of us in the Eastern District of New York, and has served as Chief Counsel to the Vice President of the United States. I'm going to ask you to give our distinguished panel a round of applause right up front. We will begin by hearing from the judge, followed by Professor Harrison, by Professor Amar, by Professor Nurse. We will then have questions among the panelists, and then, as time allows, we will have questions from the audience. You will state your name, your affiliation, and you will ask one and only one question. And should you violate that rule, you will find out that there could indeed be more than one Lord Vader in this world. So with that, Your Honor.
Thank you for that gracious introduction. I don't have to say either the H word or the Y word at any time during my talk. Justice Scalia famously plugged for rules and opposed standards. He sometimes filed short concurring opinions, objecting to multi-factor approaches. And when he had the assignment for the majority, he tended to announce approaches with as much rule-like capacity as his colleagues would allow. He wrote an article explaining this preference with the telling title, "The Rule of Law as a Law of Rules." He saw rules as vital to promoting the treatment of like cases alike. With multi-factor standards, nothing is dispositive and disparate treatment is assured. I won't catalog the other reasons he gave, but will highlight a few major considerations, but in my way rather than his. Some people, well represented in the academy, the bar, and the press, tell us that Justice Scalia's preference for rules stemmed from his politics or his religion. That's not tenable. Take the First Amendment's Establishment Clause. Justice Scalia favored the neutrality rule. A law is valid if it treats religion and secular activities and speakers the same way. Justice Ginsburg and some others support a different rule. Government never can support religious organizations and speakers, no matter how it treats secular and irreligious activities. A prohibitory rule and a neutral rule, but both rules. In the middle, Justice O'Connor favored balancing, a non-rule, as does Justice Breyer. Again, we have support from standards from people with very different approaches to law and political questions. And this runs through our jurisprudence. It's not sound to say that conservatives favor rules while liberals favor standards. The disagreement, when it comes in particular cases, rests on something else. Why did Justice Scalia favor rules? I'll give you two answers. First, that he did not favor rules, but that the text he was interpreting did. So when the text had a rule, he deployed it. For example, the Seventh Amendment says that the right of jury trial shall be preserved. That creates a rule. The Sixth Amendment says that defendants are entitled to confront and cross-examine their accusers. Another rule, to be enforced as a rule rather than watered down through interest balancing. The First Amendment says no restrictions on the freedom of speech, which covers political campaigns, and that can't be diluted by contentions that a given regulation is beneficial. The Constitution takes out of our hands what is wise. Justice Scalia treated speech the same categorical way as Alexander Micheljohn and John Hart Ely. No conservatives they. But the Fourth Amendment says that searches and seizures must be reasonable. That's a standard which Justice Scalia tried to implement as a standard. It can't have been a surprise that he found thermal imaging of houses and GPS locators on cars to be problematic under a reasonableness standard. Put a word such as reasonable in the Constitution and you get common law decision making. Justice Scalia tried to get out of the Constitution what is there in its text. No more, but no less. That usually meant rules, but not always. Now, I said that he had a second reason to prefer rules, and it stemmed from the nature of the judicial process. The Constitution doesn't have a judicial review clause. The role of judges in evaluating the constitutionality of other actors' choices depends on the constitutional structure. The Constitution beats ordinary law in a hierarchy. But this creates a bad incentive for judges. what you can think of as the dark side of judicial tenure, just like the dark side of the force. The dark side in either case is self-indulgence. Tenure is designed to free judges from politics, the better to enforce commands laid down in prior years, but no longer liked so well among the people, the press, and the legislature. Judges don't answer to the electorate, so they can and should follow the original decision until it is repealed or amended. But tenure can free judges from law, free them to follow their own druthers. That's the dark side, and we see all too much of it on the bench. When John Marshall articulated the rationale for judicial review in Marbury against Madison, the great Chief Justice stressed that the Constitution beats ordinary law only when the Constitution is itself a source of law. Rules satisfy the Marbury standards, that satisfy those standards suffice. Other things don't. So in McCulloch against Maryland, which raised the question whether Congress has authority to create a national bank, Chief Justice Marshall wrote that there's no rule about banks in the Constitution. There are vague grants of power, but they have to be fleshed out through the political process, because anything else makes judges the effective legislators. We didn't rise up against a tenured king of England to hand debatable choices to a tenured judiciary. The political branches are on short leashes, with no term longer than a senator's 6 years, and the president, of course, is under a term limit. Unless there's a real decision in the Constitution, judges have to let the electorate prevail. But justices can serve 30 years, as Justice Scalia did, or even longer. To keep to the rationale of Marbury, the court has to look for rules rather than moral or political principles. Well, what does that have to do with something like the Establishment Clause, which is written as if it were a rule but lacks much content? One possibility for Justice Scalia would have been to say that the clause means exactly what it says. The Congress can neither establish a national church nor interfere with the churches established by the states. You may not know that when the United States was created, more than half the states had established churches. But long before Justice Scalia arrived on the court, other justices had said that the First Amendment imposes limits on the states, and that's incompatible with the original meaning. So there are two other possibilities. Ignore the original meaning and just make things up as you go along. That's what the balancers do. Or adopt a second best rule. Justice Scalia chose the second best approach as the one that entails a more modest judicial role. That leaves a choice of rules. The neutrality approach to establishment provides more space for legislation than does the wall of separation approach. Naturally, Justice Scalia chose neutrality, not because it is more in the Constitution than any other approach, but because the rationale of Marbury and McCulloch is to make judicial review dependent on leaving policy choices to legislatures. The wall of separation approach removes judicial discretion at the cost of removing legislative discretion. The neutrality approach limits judicial discretion while preserving substantial room for political choice. Now let me turn from the Constitution to statutes. Justice Scalia was known as a textualist for both the Constitution and statutory interpretation. But the second constitutional consideration that I have mentioned, the need to find a doctrine that both decides the case and justifies giving the judiciary the final decision, doesn't apply to statutory interpretation. Judges have the final say in each case, of course, but the legislature has the final say about what statutes there are. So for statutes, only the first of my considerations, the need to implement the text as written, plays an important role. For Justice Scalia, this foreclosed the use of legislative history to turn rules into standards. After all, Congress enacts and the president signs only the statutory text. But the need to implement the text as written does not regularly favor rules over standards, for texts come in many forms. Some are rule-like and must be enforced as rules. Others are standards, and some of them even delegate power elsewhere. Think for a moment about the delegation to an agency. Justice Scalia was happy to defer to an agency's decision under Chevron, provided that the agency didn't contradict the statute. That would exceed the delegation. But otherwise, Chevron is consistent with his jurisprudence because often, when the statute does not create its own rule, then somebody else has to do so. And better that the someone be an agency whose leaders can be evicted in the next election, rather than judges with life tenure. The democratic approach preserves agency discretion in statutory interpretation because the judicial role is supposed to be modest. Sometimes, though, the delegation is to a court. The antitrust laws, which a panel discussed yesterday, don't decide any concrete question, but also don't authorize an agency to decide. That leaves judges. Justice Scalia was perfectly happy to engage in common law antitrust decision making. Or consider ERISA, the federal pension statute. That law preempts most state law related to pensions and leaves in its place nothing at all. Pension funds have to be held in trust, and trustees are fiduciaries. But what does that mean? Can the employer design pension or welfare plans that favor their own interests over those of workers? Yes, they can, the court has held, unanimously, because in the end, plans are contracts. Do promises of health care benefits last for the lifetime of required workers? The court has said yes and no, again unanimously, depending on what the documents say, understood in light of common law principles. No thumb on the scale for either workers or management, for either the left or the right side of political life. And when the ordinary contract principles, where do they come from? Well, by and large, they come from state law. By and large, they're standards. But that, again, respects the justices' understanding of the court's limited role. It's not to make up a new world, a brave new world, but to see what can be done with the tools on hand. One issue of rules versus standards in statutory interpretation sometimes divided the justices. A few of them occasionally contended that statutory ambiguity should be handled with a method that Aristotle called imaginative reconstruction. Justice Stevens was especially fond of this method, which entailed guessing how the sitting Congress would resolve the dispute, and then attributing that conclusion to the enacting Congress, no matter how old the statute. Now, always writing for a majority in one of these disputes, Justice Scalia replied that the exercise is illegitimate because it exalts something that has not been enacted, that is, current legislative beliefs, over an enacted text. And he sometimes added that the method is even worse than legislative history because it relies on nothing that anyone has written down and adopted. A few years back, the justices decided a wonderful case showing how inaccurate such predictions are. Now, maybe we can talk about that dispute later. For now, I just want to wrap up by saying that a textualist such as Justice Scalia prefers neither rules nor standards in statutory interpretation, but tries to implement the enacted text at its own level of generality. But that when the judge has discretion, rules are preferable because they treat equal cases equally and curtail the discretion of people you can't turn out of office. And that's a worthy approach for any judge. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to be using some of Justice Scalia's thinking about the constitutional structure to criticize what he famously said about rules and standards. So the video that we saw was fortuitous, by which I mean an accident. I'm sure Justice Scalia, if he were here, would point out that fortuitous doesn't mean fortunate, which is a happy accident. Whether it's a happy accident, I will leave to you. In James B. Beam, Justice Scalia, talking about the judicial role, said, "Judges make law, but they make it as judges make it. which is to say, as though they were finding it, discerning what the law is, rather than decreeing what it is today change to, or what it will tomorrow be. That, I think, is a fundamental principle, and it has important applications for Justice Scalia's thinking about rules and standards, which, as I say, I will partially criticize in his great article about the law of rule, the rule of laws, the law of rules. He famously argued in favor of rules on policy grounds, saying that when judges have discretion to formulate policy, as Judge Easterbrook was just talking about, they should use that discretion in a rule-like fashion because rules have many virtues. That raises the question, when are exercises of judicial discretion permissible, given all the considerations, again, that Judge Easterbrook just talked about? One answer that you might get from the kind of vulgar legal realist that every law student is for a little while at least is, well, sometimes the law isn't clear. And when the law isn't clear, judges should do the right thing. That's like saying that sometimes judges take bribes. And when they do that, they should take it from the desirable parties. A better argument is that sometimes judges interpret practices. That is to say, sometimes the law is inherently unwritten, as with common law. And there are powerful theories according to which the interpretation of a practice is necessarily a normative process, that the interpreter must decide what the practice is for, and therefore make normative and policy judgments. That may be true. It's not relevant here because Justice Scalia said judges should use standards when they make doctrine in interpreting written law. So inherently unwritten law, not on the table. It's also possible that sometimes the written law of the Constitution or a statute refers to some moral truth, some moral reality, in which case judges would have to make moral judgments. But by hypothesis, those would be moral judgments about questions of fact, and not, as Ronald Dworkin said, and not independent independent policy judgments by the judges. So we can put that aside too. There's a considerable debate these days among originalists about the process called construction, and whether the linguistic content of written rules is inadequate to supply abstract principles that can then be applied to particular cases. Some say that happens a lot, that that problem calls for what's called construction, that construction is inherently a normative process requiring the exercise of discretion and policy choices. Others deny that, say that the linguistic resources of interpretation are adequate to produce abstract principles that can then be applied to concrete cases. I'm not going to try to adjudicate that dispute. I think Justice Scalia didn't believe in construction, thought that linguistic resources were adequate. For the time being, I'll assume he was right, and so put that aside as a possible context in which judges might exercise policy discretion. But nevertheless, those abstract principles have to be applied to concrete cases. And when a court has to do that, it may ask, should the abstract principle be applied using an all things considered test, if the abstract principle seems to call for one, or should the court formulate a doctrine, that is to say, a generalization? Borrowing from Judge Easterbrook, I'll use a famous example from the 19th century, the original package doctrine. The Constitution says states may not tax imports. But at what point does an object cease to be an import and become just a piece of property subject to the taxing power of the state? That is a problem of vagueness that could be approached through, in every case, asking, under all the facts of this case, is this thing still an import? The Marshall Court created the original package doctrine, made things simple and said, as long as it's still in the original package, it's an import. After that, it is intermingled with the general property of the state and subject to the taxing power of the state. That is a generalization. It takes an inherently vague textual concept and makes it more concrete by ignoring certain facts. That's how doctrine works. Generalizations call for the application of policy discretion, because in deciding whether to use a generalization, the court has to decide what kind of errors to make, and therefore must weigh the cost of different kinds of errors. If the court decides to use a generalization, it must then pick a generalization. That too will require policy discretion. So now in the question whether to use a generalization, a rule, we have found, I think, an area in which courts legitimately may exercise policy discretion. it's important to see that when the court decides to use a generalization, a rule-like implementation, in a particular case, it has so far only decided the particular case. It's the rules of stare decisis that turn those decisions in particular cases into what we think of as judge-made law. Subsequent courts, horizontally or vertically, may be required by the rules of stare decisis to accept the reasoning of the prior case. If the subsequent court accepts the reasoning of the prior case, it too will use the generalization. The generalization will become law or doctrine. As I say, it's important to see that simply using a generalization in a particular case doesn't make doctrine. It's generalizations in particular cases plus stare decisis that makes doctrine. Now, what kind of considerations are legitimate when a court decides whether to use a rule, a generalization, and throw out some facts in a particular case? I'm going to suggest that some considerations are legitimate and some are not for structural reasons having to do with the way courts operate. Probably the most important reason to use a generalization is to decide the case correctly that is before the court. In particular, Justice Scalia said, one of the great things about a rule-like approach that doesn't take an all things considered approach and throws out some facts is that when courts take all things considered approaches and don't throw out some facts, they are more likely simply to decide on the basis of their own views about what the rule should be rather than what it is. The court's views about what the rule should be are not the law, and so a generalization that disciplines the court in the particular case before it can legitimately function to perform something that is worth doing, which is keeping the courts from deciding on the basis of their policy views about the law that is before them. Similarly, generalizations make decision-making quicker and easier, and that too is a legitimate consideration in a particular case because there is always a next case waiting to be decided. So the sooner this case can be decided, the better. Those are legitimate considerations, I think, because they apply to the resolution of the particular case before the court. Justice Scalia also said famously, in talking about rules and standards, that the advantage of rules is that they create clarity going forward for future parties. Well, that is a good thing about rules. That is a virtue of rules. That's a good reason for a legislature to use rules. But courts aren't legislatures. The parties not before the courts, I will argue, are not legitimate objects for the court's concern precisely because they are not before the courts. To ask about the ex ante effect of some legal norm on non-parties in the future is precisely to perform the legislative function. Notice that everything I said before about how courts can make policy decisions as to whether to use generalizations concerns the application of abstract principles to the particular case before the court, and so is a legitimate side effect of the exercise of the judicial power, the resolution of concrete disputes. To look forward to non-parties, by contrast, is to do what legislatures distinctively do and what courts do not do. It is inconsistent with the allocation of powers in the Constitution. So that kind of consideration, I think, is illegitimate for a court in deciding whether or not to use a rule rather than a standard, a generalization. I will say, since we're talking about Justice Scalia and separation of powers in the constitutional structure, that the principle I'm applying here, so-called judicial lawmaking through the process of deciding cases must be disciplined by the adjudicatory function, is precisely what Justice Scalia said in the case about the Sentencing Commission, Mistretta against the United States. He said that the problem with the Sentencing Commission is that it doesn't do anything but make law. And therefore, it can't do what an executive agency does when the executive agency adopts a regulation. Justice Scalia was adamant on the point that delegations to executive agencies are a figure of speech. What really happens is that the executive agency exercises executive power in carrying out a law, and the law may call for it to act with the force and effect of law. So the effect of legislation must be accomplished through the reality of executive power. The problem, he said, with the Sentencing Commission was no executive power, nothing being carried out, just in one of his famous phrases, a junior varsity Congress. But the fundamental principle was the executive can do something that is like lawmaking only when it is really executing. My principle is that the courts can do something that is like lawmaking, that is metaphorically legislation, only when they are really adjudicating, and that to be really adjudicating, they must be deciding about the particular parties before them on the basis, as Justice Scalia said in James B. Beam, of the law as it now exists and not as it may be in the future. So both of those metaphors, executive lawmaking, judicial lawmaking, must be cashed out in terms of the actual allocation of power, the executive function of executive agencies in carrying out the law, the adjudicatory function of courts in applying existing principles to concrete cases. So if the answer to what I've just said is, but everyone knows that courts make law, well, as Robert Bork said, what we all know is wrong.
Good morning. It's always a pleasure to be with you at the Federalist Society. Thanks so much for many years of friendship. So what's the relationship between the syntactical form in which a legal proposition appears in the Constitution and how judges should implement, interpret, apply that proposition in cases? So let me use some examples from Justice Scalia's oeuvre. We heard earlier that he very famously said in Morrison versus Olson that this wolf comes as a wolf. He would have liked to hear that rose is a rose is a rose. He thought a rule was a rule was a rule. And here's an example of that. So if the textual form of a proposition in the Constitution is rule-like, he wanted the judges to respect that in their implementation. So here's a famous case of his. It's called Maryland versus Craig. He's actually in dissent. It's from 1990. It involves the Confrontation Clause. This was a situation in which there was an allegation of sexual abuse, and the victim was allowed under a statute to testify via a one-way closed-circuit television, so there wasn't face-to-face confrontation between the defendant and the victim. And here's what Justice Scalia said, because I think he would love it if we heard his words, and their classic Scalia. This is in dissent. Because the court said, that's okay, there are some good reasons for this, and Justice Scalia would have none of it. Seldom has this court failed so conspicuously to sustain a categorical guarantee of the Constitution. The Sixth Amendment provides, with unmistakable clarity, that, and here you see the voice of a textualist, with unmistakable clarity, that in all criminal prosecutions, the accused shall enjoy the right to be confronted with the witnesses against him. And then he says, that text means a defendant's right to face his or her accusers, and there's an etymological discussion of confrontation, the face-to-face, brow-to-brow, eyeball-to-eyeball exchange, and that's precisely what Maryland was not offering. Here's the last paragraph of this classic dissent. The court today has applied interest-balancing analysis, where the text of the Constitution simply does not permit it. We're not free to conduct a cost-benefit analysis of clear and explicit, that would be rule-like, constitutional guarantees, and then to adjust their meaning to comport with our findings. The court has convincingly proved, and this is the court that he's mocking, Justice O'Connor writing for the court, the majority, has convincingly proved that the Maryland procedure serves a valid interest and gives the defendant virtually everything the Confrontation Clause guarantees. Everything that is, except confrontation. I am persuaded, therefore, that the Maryland procedure is virtually constitutional. Since it is not, however, actually constitutional, I dissent. Okay, so good. I'm glad you're on what would Scalia do? That's what Scalia did, and I'm glad you're hearing his words, his voice, his vision. Now, what's the mistake? If a rule is a rule, he says, enforce it as a rule. The mistake would be, what Justice O'Connor did for the majority, apply the rule as a standard, as just a mushy balancing test. Now, that one involved face-to-face confrontation, and here's what Justice Scalia said. She says, well, you know, our doctrine treats hearsay as the subject, basically, of the confrontation clause, and since actually we do allow some sorts of hearsay, if it's really reliable, we balance all the time. That's what we do in the confrontation clause. This one wasn't a hearsay case. It was about face-to-face confrontation, but it leads Justice Scalia to begin to think about the hearsay understanding of the confrontation clause, and that's eventually going to lead to the revolution in confrontation clause jurisprudence led by Justices Thomas and Scalia, a case called Crawford versus Washington, in which Justice Scalia, writing for the court in 2004, recasts the inquiry, offers a more rule-like account of the confrontation clause, and here's now one way in which actually sometimes a rule-like account operates. It shrinks the domain of the proposition in order to make it more amenable to a crisp, clear rule. What's a witness? Who's a witness? Well, if you think that a witness, confrontation clause says you have a right to confront witnesses against you, if you think that a witness is a statement that's introduced for the truth of the proposition asserted, well, you're not gonna be able to say that's categorically prohibited because there are just all sorts of situations in which hearsay is gonna be properly admissible. But if you have a narrower view, I say to Victoria, oh, gee, I saw Frank running down the street the other day, and I have no idea that a crime has even been committed. And then later on, Victoria testifies, well, Akhil saw Frank running down the street that day. Is that a witness? Am I the witness when she takes the stand and testifies? Well, if you have a hearsay understanding of the thing, it's an utterance that's introduced for the truth of the matter asserted, then I'm the witness. But if you have a narrower view, know what a witness is someone who in effect offers a testimonial-like statement to the government itself, knowing that he's offering it, she's offering it to the government itself. Well, then you can actually have a more rule-like and crisper and absolute understanding of the Confrontation Clause, and that's just what Justice Scalia offers in Crawford. I myself prefer Justice Thomas's rendition of it to Justice Scalia's, but what they're both trying to do is make the Confrontation Clause implementation more accurately reflect the linguistic structure of the clause, which is rule-like and not interest-balancing. And my one claim is sometimes you do that by restricting the scope of application, and then maybe, and here this bears on what my colleagues have just talked about, is a rule is a rule, but should interpreters also take seriously the principle underlying the rule, maybe apply that in other situations, although perhaps less categorically? But if a rule is a rule, is a standard a standard? At his best, Justice Scalia said, yes. So let's take the Fourth Amendment, which prohibits unreasonable searches and seizures. Here's a Justice Scalia concurrence in a case called California versus Acevedo. It's from 1991. It involves some very technical issues about cars and compartments in cars and packages in cars and the doctrine is completely confused. Welcome to the Fourth Amendment. Here's what Justice Scalia says in his concurrence. The Fourth Amendment does not, by its terms, require a prior warrant for searches and seizures. It merely prohibits searches and seizures that are unreasonable. Doesn't love that, you see, because he likes rules, and he's now admitting it's a standard. So maybe we can actually read the standard as if it's a rule. He says, although the Fourth Amendment does not explicitly impose the requirement of a warrant, it's of course textually permissible to consider that implicit within it is a warrant requirement, implicit within the requirement of reasonableness. So he's open to the idea that maybe implicitly it's a rule, but the problem is that you can't make sense of that doctrinally. If you actually required a warrant for each and every search and seizure, it just wouldn't work. And he catalogs nearly 20 exceptions to the so-called warrant requirement. So you just can't operationalize it as a rule. And so he says, in my view, the path out of this confusion should be sought by returning to first principles. That basically reasonableness is the requirement of the Fourth Amendment. That's great, you know, all the greater that he cites some good scholarship on that point. You know what I mean. But he doesn't love it because even though he's a rule is a rule person and read it for what it says, he doesn't love, there's a tension when he's dealing with standards, because on the one hand, a standard is a standard. On the other hand, he's a rule person and he doesn't love standards. So later on, I think he actually undercuts what he said in California versus Acevedo in a case about a DNA testing of mere arrestees. He's in dissent, a case called Maryland versus King, what Justice Alito said might be the most important criminal procedure case really of the last generation. And here's what Justice Scalia says. He's in dissent, and he says, the Fourth Amendment forbids searching a person for evidence of a crime when there's no basis for believing the person is guilty of the crime or is in the possession of incriminating evidence. That prohibition is categorical and without exception. It lies at the very heart of the Fourth Amendment. Well, that sounds great. The only problem is the Fourth Amendment doesn't say so. No framer ever said so. He's introducing all sorts of distinctions like evidence for criminal prosecutions and all the rest that the Fourth Amendment doesn't talk about criminal prosecutions versus civil. He's seeking to take what he understood way back when to be a standard, turning it into a rule, but actually it isn't a rule. So I think that was, with due respect, a mistake on his part. Let me give you one other example, and then I'll sit down. So rules are rules, standards, and Justice O'Connor doesn't quite believe that. She thinks rules are mushy interest balancing. Standards are standards. That's what Justice Scalia gets in California versus Acevedo and forgets later on in Maryland versus King. Okay, but how about rules are rules, but we often have to supplement them. By a more flexible standard, or read them at a higher level of generality because they're nested within a larger constitutional system that has to make sense. Justice Scalia sometimes mocked that thought, but actually sometimes implemented that idea. This is what he said about the First Amendment in A Matter of Interpretation, his classic book on the nature of interpretation. Quote, take, for example, the provision of the First Amendment that forbids abridgment of the freedom of speech or of the press. That phrase does not list the full range of communicative expression. Handwritten letters, for example, are neither speech nor press. Yet surely there is no doubt they cannot be censored. In this constitutional context, speech and press, the two most common forms of communication, stand as a sort of synecdoche for the whole. This is not strict construction, but it is reasonable construction. Okay, so handwritten letters. He says, well, they're not speech or press, but we should read the First Amendment as if it's about some higher level idea, freedom of expression. Now, I'm with him on this. And what's really interesting is, without knowing about that paragraph, which because it hadn't been published yet, it had just been spoken at a lecture, I used the exact same example in a piece in the Harvard Law Review, handwritten letters. I'm with him on that, but there is a little bit of a tension between that approach, which I think is sensible and structural, and this more narrow, literalistic rules are rules are rule, because you see, speech by its nature is inherently limited by the range of my voice. I can't speak across the city or this country, but I could send a letter across this city or this country, a handwritten letter. So actually freedom of speech is in its very nature rather, you know, you could make some distinctions between that and a handwritten letter. You could say, oh, well, a handwritten letter is like a printing press. you're pressing ink on paper, but you could also say it's different because at the time of the Constitution, very few people had printing presses, and the freedom of the press was actually about licensing the few printing presses that existed, and that's very different than all letters. And so if you wanted to, you could say, actually, a handwritten letter isn't freedom of the press. It's different than a printing press. It isn't freedom of speech because it's not limited in geographically, locationally, the way the oral word is. He chose not to. I think he chose wisely not to, in part because there's a larger constitutional context in which free expression, especially political expression, would need to be part of our system, even if we didn't have the words of the First Amendment. So says Micklejohn, so says Bork, so says Charles Black. So I just leave you now with three examples of Justice Scalia in action. Justice Scalia at his best. Rules are rules, standards are standards, and sometimes, for good structural reasons, we enforce the rule in all its absoluteness, but we also supplement it by a broader principle. It might be a standard that makes structural sense. The Constitution permits more rights, but not less. If a rule's a rule, we enforce it. That's the Ninth Amendment idea. Unfortunately, is an idea that Justice Scalia didn't always take seriously in cases like Troxell, but at his best he did, and I think at his best you see that in particular with this very interesting example of handwritten letters. Thank you very much.
Well, I want to thank Dean Reuter and the Federalist Society for having me here yet again, and I confess, I feel like I'm a bit of a walking oxymoron, and my talk today will be in a little bit of a different register than the erudite talks by my fellow panelists. I am a walking oxymoron in part because I am the only feminist on the planet whose first article was on the Federalist Papers and agreed entirely with Justice Scalia about the importance of the structure of the Constitution. And I get into debates with my friend Randy Burnett about that all the time. Over at Georgetown, but I was delighted to see the opening here today. I'm also a bit of an oxymoron because I'm one of 5% of law professors, not only at the H school or the Y school, the V school, the C school, the G school, and the top 20% of law schools in America who have any experience in a legislature, namely the Congress, not to mention the White House. Finally, being a liberal, I will argue oxymoronically for rules. So a bit of a roadmap. I want to say that Justice Scalia did an extraordinary thing for the Legal Academy when he gave these lectures a matter of interpretation, which is, if you haven't read it, reread it, reread it again. I give it to all of my students. If he can, in fact, do what he said he would do to change the legal curriculum of America's law schools, it would be tremendous. With all due respect to Langdale and Harvard, he came to my law school. He was very generous at Georgetown with his time. And he would pronounce that, in fact, law schools needed to stop teaching about the common law as much and teach about statutes, about texts. And this is a very important lesson, and it's an important lesson because we do not, even at my own law school, teach about texts in the first semester or at many law schools. And I think that this is a shame. It's an anachronism. So I'm deeply indebted to him for having said that because statutory interpretation has been the great subject of my scholarship for the last decade. So first, I'm going to admit my priors. About my agreements and disagreements with Justice Scalia on this topic. I will second defend a set of rules that are supported in the Constitution by rule that I had hoped to convince him were worthy of his attention. And then I want to note something about how I felt as I was teaching on the day of his death. So first, as an intellectual matter, I have to admit my priors. Judge Easterbrook's colleague on the Seventh Circuit, Judge Posner in print, and Judge Ripple recently at a conference at Loyola have said some very nice things about a book I wrote, which has an unfortunate title because it is in response to Justice Scalia's enormously powerful book, Reading Law. My book has the unfortunate title of Misreading Law, although I managed to have the Harvard University Press publish it. But it would not have existed without Justice Scalia. I will tell you, however, that it is equally tough on purposivists, which is the ugliest word I have ever heard. I believe the Hart and Sachs school, which in a tome of 1,000 pages had five on the Congress, five. We do have a republic, you know. Left us with imaginary construction, as just Easterbrook has told you. I am certainly not, and nor was the judge I clerked for, a man named Weinfeld, an imaginary reconstructionist. So I am hard on both existing schools. Like Groucho Marx, I have no friends. But for this audience, I want to try to defend some rules I think are underappreciated in the Constitution and have had something to do with my view of how best to look at the difficult cases, the very hard cases, when the statute is vague, when there is no text, nor is there even a principle, or when, in fact, as I teach my students, it's often that there are two plain meanings. An extensivist meaning, which would be more of a standard, which is to say all senses of, let's say, labor in the famous Holy Trinity case, all labor, or the prototypical manual labor. And most linguists will tell you that you can find a standard-like, a principle-like meaning, a plain meaning that is both a prototype as well as an extension of the term, which leaves you in many cases, certainly the cases that are achieved in appellate courts and in the Supreme Court, with vagueness, and you must go somewhere. Well, where do you go? Well, in the book, I defend looking at legislative evidence, which will horrify you all. I call it evidence, not history, because if you do history, you're never going to find it. Trust me. There's nothing I ever worked on when I was in the Senate that was ever reported accurately by the press. But then again, as I heard in, unfortunately, and I'll mention this later, CNN reported last night, we are in a post-truth age. I'll get back to that. In any event, I want to talk about a different set of rules, the rules that actually govern Congress. Yes, they have rules. Who knew? It's actually in Article 1, Section 5. But I once was at a conference, I'm sorry, I'm picking on Harvard, Judge, where I asked people, what is the most important rule in the Republic? And I said, I'll give you the number. Because we all love numbers, right? You know, 10b-5, you know, 10k, all that stuff. I said, it's 22. And there was a large silence. This was a conference on legal education, and everyone was looking at me very perplexed. And then someone in the back of the room raised their hand and said, interpleader. And I said, do you think the Republic would end if we got rid of interpleader? And I said, no, I was actually thinking a rule of the Senate, Rule 22. Rule 22 is the cloture rule. It is the only way, once Aaron Burr got rid of the motion for a previous question, yes, sorry, he was treasonous in many ways, it's the only way you can stop debate in the Senate. Now, what does that mean? It means we have a 60-vote system. We've always had a 60-vote system. It means that we have a supermajoritarian system, that it is built into the Constitution, and maybe for good reasons, as my friend John McGinnis says. But it isn't interpleader. Now, lest we give up all hope of a representative republic, we must learn something, I think, about how that republic works on both ends of Pennsylvania Avenue as well as inside the Supreme Court. The day after the election, I received several calls from people from both sides of the aisle about the filibuster, reconciliation, and other terms that generally do not grace any law school classroom in America. I think this is sad. Why? Because you get that knowledge not from law schools, but it's sold every day in this town by lobbyists. And this is the kind of thing that anyone who has voted for civics or general education should be resoundingly for. These are rules, and these rules do matter. They cannot simply be evaded except in the Senate by unanimous consent. Now, I believe that these rules have a basis in the Constitution. Article 1, Section 5 provides that each house, not both houses, each house may create the rules of its own proceedings and then report these in a journal. Now, the founders believed that this was a very important provision of the Constitution. Imagine if the President of the United States, whether the President-elect or the current president, had the power to change the rules of the Senate. Imagine any reform you like, a wall, amnesty, DACA, DAPA, healthcare, not healthcare, repeal, pro. If the president can change the rules, it makes it very easy for him to get his program furthered. The founders understood that. That's why they gave it to Congress themselves, and they divided it up to support the bicameralism clause, Article 1, Section 7, which Justice Scalia deservedly loved. So these rules are important. They are important to teach, I believe, because we are at a time when these rules will become important. They are also important to understanding how to read statutes when there is vagueness. Now, I understand that Justice Scalia and I disagree about what I call legislative evidence. He infamously called it garbage. And I must say that I find that a bit excessive. I agree that there is no such thing as legislative intent, and that that is a very bad idea. Max Radin had a very silly skeptical argument, which in my book I refute. But I do believe that the materials that Congress creates, committee reports, conference reports, these at least people should understand their differences. For example, conference reports are text. They're not some imagined belief. They're like 10Ks. They're like any document that can be admitted into evidence. In 1842, the Supreme Court agreed that they could be admitted into evidence for whatever they are worth. And sometimes they're worth nothing according to the rules. Why? Well, let's imagine that you wanted to cite some legislative evidence that the opponents of the bill propounded, or a committee report that, yes, was passed after the president signed the bill. And yes, that can happen. This is bad legislative evidence. And it's bad legislative evidence because no one within the body would consider it good legislative evidence, bipartisan evidence, evidence that the rules of the body delegate to those inside and give it the meaning of the full Congress, just as every corporation has delegation rules. It's no different from that. So the problem I find, the deepest one, is about what I call the supermajoritarian difficulty in statutory interpretation, which is to say that if you cite those things that are contrary to the rules, those who opposed a bill, it's as if you're citing a dissent as a majority. Judge Mikva famously said that his views of the RICO statute, when he opposed it, then became its meaning in the Supreme Court. Justice Scalia and I would agree that is terrible. That is awful. On the other hand, I do believe that it is important when we are in an age where it is easy to believe that, as my friend from the University of Virginia said, law students are too easily wed to the notion of a false realism, the kind of Radin-esque silly realism, that it is all politics. It seems very important to me at this point in time to preserve what I went to that Harvard conference so many years ago to do, and I was somewhat lambasted for. But I believe very strongly, and why I keep coming back to the Federalist Society, in a very conservative distinction between law and politics. And I believe it because I have lived it on both sides of Pennsylvania Avenue and as a clerk for a very distinguished judge, as an appellate advocate for George H.W. Bush. And I can tell you that this is exactly the kind of thing that is so important today if we are at an age of fake news, post-truth. The courts are the last repository of reason. We believe in evidence, and we may be tested in the future. Thank you very much. I appreciate your time.
The last time I had someone make this much fun of Harvard, I was sitting with my friend, Second Circuit Judge Denny Chin, and he was laughing at the fact that there were two Harvard men who were fumbling the oath of office as President Obama was about to be sworn in. I pointed out to my good friend Denny, however, that there were two Harvard men who were exchanging. A number of reversals followed, and I learned my lesson. All right. We're now going to have our distinguished panelists fire questions at one another. Have at it.
Well, I'd like to say a few words in response to Professor Nurse's talk about Congress from the inside. First, I want to defend Justice Scalia against the implicit charge that he really wanted to ignore the legislative process. He's actually on record as saying that if you have real process that leaves evidence behind, if, for example, there is a motion to amend a law and the motion fails, you don't want to then interpret the law as if the motion had succeeded. Right? The legislative process can leave behind things that matter. I may need to sharpen a little what I said about legislative history. What Justice Scalia believed and said is that legislative history doesn't count as law, and that's for the reasons of provenance. What counts as law in our system is something that both houses of Congress pass and the president signs, or something that the president doesn't sign and two-thirds of each House of Congress votes for. But since nobody votes for the legislative history and the president doesn't sign it, it doesn't count as law. But it may count as evidence in the sense that we understand words generally the way the community of listeners understands them. It's not what's in the heads of the speaker that counts. Law is addressed to an outside audience. So it's how the listeners understand particular language. And it's entirely conceivable that what's in a legislative report might tell you something about how people used words at the time. And the older the legislation, and the more the language has changed in between, the more important that use might be. But it's not as if it's, for Justice Scalia, it's not that it's being used as law, but it may have some use for our understanding of the language. What particularly concerned me about her talk, I agree with everything about her talk until the end, which suggests that those who are well-versed in the legislative process know some secret sauce that's relevant to interpretation. Justice Scalia was not of that mind, nor am I, precisely because law is addressed to society at large. It's signed by someone outside Congress, the addressees are outside Congress. For law to be successful in communicating an idea, that idea has to be understandable to and interpretable by people who have never been inside Congress. The law has value to the extent it has signs and symbols ascertainable by the outsiders. So I'm entirely in favor of the project of those with inside knowledge explaining how Congress works. It's a really bad idea when the judiciary interprets laws by making assumptions about Congress that are factually untrue. But it's also very important, it was terribly important to Justice Scalia, that law be interpretable by people outside the body with no knowledge of secret sauce.
Professor?
I'm not much of a cook, but I don't think this should be secret sauce. And if I had my way with a lot of other folks who teach basic civics, I think it's important for judges as well as lawyers to understand basics. I don't think that legislative evidence in many cases yields good results. I do think that it's irrational not to look at evidence in context if you know that the context exists. And many political scientists agree with me. I understand judges are afraid of this. Law professors are afraid of this. I mean, my colleagues don't teach this. I think it largely is because of my own experience that I think that I have a very different take. When you ask me to look at the legislative evidence, I'll tell you that's a bunch of bunk. And if I can do it, it seems to me everyone can do it. And if you don't teach it, you're gonna get folks who don't agree with Justice Scalia, this is my attack on the purposivists, looking at very bad legislative evidence. Now, as far as laws, I don't think it's law either. I do think, however, the question is whether you're going to use canons of interpretation or legislative evidence. I believe Justice Scalia would prefer canons, which, interestingly enough, as Judge Posner, your colleague, has said, is more like a standard than a rule because there is no key to which canons shall apply. So my argument is for legislative evidence in the particular case because, in fact, it's likely to be the best, as Judge Easterbrook indicated, sense of semantic meaning. And Justice Scalia would look at legislative drafting, but if you're going to look at legislative drafting, know what you're looking at. Because, in fact, there are arguments in the Supreme Court of the United States where fine advocates confuse simple things like the conference report and a committee report. One comes at the end of the procedure and one comes at the beginning. That's all I'm asking for from law schools, a very basic, rudimentary knowledge. Not inside, not, you know, Abby Gluck's, let me interview 5,000 people. There is a basic set of procedures.
Professor Harrison, do you have a comment on this?
Well, not exactly this, but related to what Professor Norris said.
So yes, can, of course.
Because, one of the great questions associated with Rule 22 of the Senate is whether in the exercise of its rulemaking power, either House of Congress can bind itself. That is to say, are the entrenching rules in the Senate rules, which purport like Article 5 to impose limitations on further changes themselves, valid. And the observation I want to make is that's connected to our topic of rules and standards, because the idea of a rule is intimately connected with the idea of legal formality. Rules are formal in the sense that they are not transparent to their purposes. In order to determine whether any text is transparent to its purpose, of course, as Professor Marr was saying, you have to attend to its language, try to find out how much information the language is going to give you about that. And if you don't mind, I'm going to ask and see if anybody has a thought on this, because I have an idea about Rule 22 of the Senate and the whole entrenching system in the rules of the Senate connected to the text of the Constitution. And I'm going to put out an hypothesis and see if anyone thinks that I am over-reading the text. And the hypothesis is that neither House of Congress may bind itself, that the entrenching rules are ineffective and can be dispensed with at any time by either House of Congress, but not for reasons having to do with, well, there's a general principle that legislative bodies can't bind themselves, but a very narrow textual argument that the relevant provisions, both Article 1, Section 7, with respect to legislative power and here the rulemaking powers, speak in an eternal present. They say Congress shall. And if you think that is meaningful, that means that at every moment, Congress has the legislative power and so can't bind itself through prior legislation. At every moment, each house has the rulemaking power and so can change its rules and can't be bound by prior attempts by the Senate itself to entrench its own rules. I actually think that's correct, but I have some doubts about it, in part because it seems to be putting a great deal of pressure on a particular verbal formulation. But deciding whether something is a rule or not often requires putting a lot of pressure on a particular verbal formulation.
Professor Lamar, your reaction?
So it's great that we're talking about in the context of a
general discussion of rules and standards, Rule 22, which I agree is hugely significant. I agree with what John Harrison said. He gave you a textual reason. I am in print in multiple places, committed to the same conclusion, but I also try to embed his textual observation in a larger set of structural and historical arguments. They appear actually, this is a very bad form, but the new a book that I'm plugging.
there will, by the way, be a book signing at the end of this across the way.
Thank you, Judge. Has three essays. One's called How to End the Filibuster Forever. A second one is called Filibuster Reform Made Simple, and a third of which is The Nuclear Option Genie is Out of the Bottle. These were a series of essays advocating the so-called nuclear option, which the Republicans were for when they were in charge, and then the Democrats were for when they were in charge, and we will see now what happens going forward. It is among the most significant constitutional issues, it seems to me, of the next administration. I think the Constitution speaks to it not just textually, but structurally and historically. And it's a reminder, again, that even though we can look at sentence by sentence and we can see whether the syntactical form is a rule and a standard, often these are embedded in larger structures of meaning.
Judge Easterbrook, do you want to go nuclear? Or
I don't want to say a word about Rule 22, but I want to bring the problem back to what Justice Scalia said. Because Congress, Rule 22 says whatever it says. But here's something that's in the public laws. There's a statute called the McCarran-Ferguson Act, which regulates insurance. And it is a reverse preemption statute. It says that state law prevails over inconsistent federal law unless the federal law expressly says that it applies to insurance. And Justice Scalia once wrote an opinion saying he thought that law was unconstitutional, not because Congress couldn't defer to the states, but because it appeared that the enacting Congress was attempting to tell the future Congress what language it must use in legislating. He spoke only for himself, and that raised a lot of eyebrows, because the alternative way to understand that clause in the McCarran-Ferguson Act is as a dictionary. Mm-hmm. That is, it's a rule of interpretation that says, here's how we're going to read language. And there are a whole bunch of things. One USC 1, the Dictionary Act, says, for example, the singular includes the plural, right? And I don't think Justice Scalia has ever said that that was unconstitutional because it was tying the hands of future Congresses, which could always legislate. So I don't want to say anything about Rule 22. I'm always afraid of what will land in litigation. But to somebody who's worried about what is the structure of a rule, saying Congress can't use a rule to tie its own hands is one thing. But saying you can't specify the meaning of words would be something completely different. Justice Scalia was known to be fond of dictionaries, which, so far as I know, are not enacted by Congress and signed by the President. You always need some objective reference for the meaning of words, which I trust is possible without transgressing constitutional limits.
On the Dictionary Act.
Hang on, I'm sorry. Let's see if the professor has a response that will turn to you.
No, I agree as far as Rule 22, I don't want to comment on Rule 22 either, to tell you the truth. We will see what happens to it. And I refer you to Professor Amar's writing. As far as I'm concerned, I don't think that, I agree with Judge Easterbrook on this. I mean, do believe that the meanings of words are things that in the Dictionary Act, for example, that can be defined by Congress, and that is not the idea of what a rule is simply by defining a word. It seems to me that Congress can do that, that that's actually that we should do more of that, in fact, that Congress often, as Aaron Brewer has written, creates its own rules within a statute for how it's going to proceed. So
I do think, actually, Congress can bind itself with respect to interpretation, because the interpretation is, in fact, enacted into law under Article 1, Section 7. But as far as rules are concerned in terms of binding, you know, the Senate, just to give you one point of reference, in fact, they do try to bind themselves, because you need two-thirds votes. You need 67 to change the rules in theory. So in theory, they attempt to bind themselves and attempt to entrench these rules, even if there remains some question, as Professor Harrison noted, about whether that is constitutional.
Professor Watt.
On the Dictionary Act, I commend to you and related issues an outstanding article by a good friend of this society's, Nick Quinn Rosencrantz, a colleague at Georgetown, Victoria Norris's at Georgetown, in the Harvard Law Review, and he asked the question, if Congress can pass laws like the Dictionary Act, can they pass laws about judicial interpretation? And tell judges, for example, how generally to construe or not construe various things, and what limits might there be on that. On Congress's capacity to bind itself or even to change default rules about what a subsequent Congress, what words or magic words a subsequent Congress might need to utter in order to repeal an existing statute and change the judicial rules about repeals by implication and whether they're favored or disfavored. There's an article by Paul Kahn, this one in the Yale Law Journal. I did put in a plug for the Harvard Law Review, Nick Quinn Rosencrantz's piece, called Graham Rudman and the Capacity of Congress to Control the Future. So those are both actually interesting pieces on this topic.
And I think it's terribly important to point out at this moment that the article, The Rule of Law is the Law of Rules, appears in the University of Chicago Law Review.
But I take it the gentleman from Virginia wishes to weigh in.
Rather than citing something in the Virginia Law Review, I will say first that maybe the most important, saying nothing against the McCarran-Ferguson Act, maybe the most important statute that has one of these magic words entrenching provisions is the War Powers Resolution, which says that the use of military force can be authorized only by subsequent statutes that refer to the War Powers Resolution and that don't do it implicitly. And the Office of Legal Counsel that Justice Scalia once headed has rejected that view on the grounds that Congress cannot limit itself in the future. I think with respect to the dictionary, I have grave doubts about the dictionary, the authority of the Dictionary Act. I think what Congress can do or can try to do, and has been trying to do with the way it deals with the War Powers Resolution, which is, in general, in the authorizations of military force that is subsequently adopted, to refer to the War Powers Resolution. Congress may be able to create conventions, both of language and of legislative process, and the conventions would then provide interpretive structures within which later Congresses can act. I think Congress can try to do that. It may succeed in doing that. But I don't think that Congress can do that simply by fiat. That is to say, Congress through the Dictionary Act may in fact be able to change the way in which words are used. If it succeeds in doing that, then yes, what it said in the Dictionary Act will be authoritative, but only because it worked through the process of actually changing linguistic usage in particular contexts.
Other questions amongst the panel? Is it time to take questions from the floor? All right. Please come forward, state your name, your affiliation, and your question. Here's an example of a question.
Coke Stewart.
What is Aleppo? That's a question. The brilliant answer that you would give and then say, what do you think of my brilliant answer? Not a question. So, with that guidance, please proceed. Welcome to Brooklyn. Please proceed.
Coke Stewart, appellate lawyer, Alexandria, and former student of Professor Harrison's from UVA. My question is, in interpreting statutes, what is the role of presidential signing statements and also subsequently passed trade agreements that are that are passed by Congress and are supposed to be consistent with U.S. law?
Thank you for your question.
I will say for signing statements that without taking a position on the relevance of legislative evidence, is that the good? Without taking a position on the relevance of legislative evidence, that they function as much as legislative evidence as anything else the president participates in the legislative process.
Which is to say they don't really count for beans. for Justice Scalia, I mean, the president actually gets the power to sign the law, but anything that somebody says after Congress has already passed it, Congress doesn't have the chance to negative the president's signing statement any more than the president has the chance to negate legislative history. But again, it may be useful for telling us what people think words mean. But if I understand the sometime objection to presidential signing statements, it doesn't have anything to do with interpretation. People get all hot and bothered about signing statements when the president says, if the law means X, I don't think it would be valid, so I'm going to construe it in practice to mean Y. And that's not really a statement about the statute's meaning. It doesn't constrain the courts or agencies about the statute's meaning, but it's a helpful statement about what the president's going to do, and then whether what he's going to do is the right thing, people can contest. I would much rather know what the president's going to do than to have him keep it under his hat.
Next question.
I'm Gene Scalia. My question is, what do you think of the following? Which is a wonderful story I thought I should share with this group about why it is that the rule of law is a law of rules is in the University of Chicago Law Review. My father gave that as the Holmes Lecture at Harvard in, I think it was 1988.
I'm sorry, where did he give that lecture?
It gets better, Your Honor. It had been a tradition at times in the past for the Holmes Lecture to be published in the Harvard Law Review. And in fact, just 2 years before, Justice Brennan's Holmes Lecture had been published in the Harvard Law Review. However, my father called me when I was the editor-in-chief of the Chicago Law Review, and he was kind of hurt. And he said, I gave this lecture, they won't publish it. They published Bill Brennan's piece just 2 years ago. I don't know why mine isn't good enough. And he said, Gene, should I have it published in the Harvard Journal of Law and Public Policy? And the Federal Society publication. And I said, well, why would you not publish it in the Chicago Law Review? And he said, well, you've got a conflict of interest. And I said, well, you know, I'll recuse myself from consideration of the piece. And I said, by the way, look, if it's a really good piece, we should be proud to run it. I said, if on the other hand, it's a lousy piece by a relatively new Supreme Court justice, that itself is sort of newsworthy. So that is the story of how that piece was snatched away from the Harvard Journal of Law and Public Policy and spurned by the Harvard Law Review. I should add, I think it's an interesting story for today about maybe a small price paid for political correctness at Harvard. And I should add as well that my father's relationship with Harvard in his later years was wonderful and a real source of happiness to him. So I thought the judge would want to hear that as well. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Nino Scalia and I have been good friends for more than 40 years. We met when we were both in the Department of Justice in the Ford administration. And he told me at the time that the Harvard editors had told him that the piece had to be rejected because it was not scholarly enough, by which they may have meant it didn't have enough footnotes, though it did have a lot more footnotes than the original Holmes. Famous lecture, The Path of the Law, which had, I think, a total of 10. But only in America would the student editors of a law review tell a justice of the Supreme Court who had held tenured positions at Virginia and the University of Chicago that he didn't know enough about scholarship.
Your question.
Thank you, Judge. My name is Craig Lean. I'm a local government attorney from Florida. The question I have is, when an administrative agency adopts a rule, there's a rulemaking process, you have an opportunity to comment. When Congress or a legislature adopts a statute, there's a statutory process. In light of that, and in some of the things that have been said, is one concern I have as a local government attorney is that sometimes when particularly an intermediate appellate court, a U.S. Court of Appeals, or a circuit, or a intermediate appellate court at the state level, adopts a rule or a doctrine in a case, particularly where you're a non-party, and you may not even know that this will come up, that becomes law. I mean, it's a binding precedent that then affects you, but you don't have the same opportunity to comment, and once it's adopted, there's really nothing you can do about it. So in light of that...
And your question is, how do we feel about that?
Well, how do you feel?
Yes, that is your question.
Yes, is that a reason why standards, although rules are great, is that a reason why standards may sometimes be more appropriate?
Thank you for your question. Panel?
I would say that's what you just described happens. It's an artifact of the way the rules of stare decisis operate these days. And 150 years ago, where it took a series of cases and courts sort of rethought what they had said in prior cases more readily, something like that would happen a lot less easily. And there is a problem with instant stare decisis because the courts are dependent on what they heard in the particular case. But again, the larger point is that depends on exactly how the rules of stare decisis work, and they can work in different ways.
The rules and standards of stare decisis.
Good morning. My name is Joe Crosby. I'm an attorney in Washington, D.C., and my question is for Judge Easterbrook. When you were describing the Establishment Clause and pointing out that we can't use an interpretation that is textual because it's about Congress's power to establish or not establish a church, you then said you need to go to a second best rule, and that in that case the best choice for a second best rule would be rule-based. Why wouldn't the best choice for a second best rule be something as close as you could get to the text of the Constitution given when you were working?
Thank you for your question.
The answer depends on who you are. And Justice Thomas commented on this last night in passing. Justice Scalia often identified himself as a faint-hearted originalist, somebody who did not want to go back and to take the devil coming next, did not want to accept Gary Lawson's proposition that stare decisis is itself unconstitutional because it gives earlier decisions of the Supreme Court a higher status than, say, that of legislators. Justice Scalia wanted to respect earlier decisions. And I wouldn't say it was strictly on the ground of decision theory that most new ideas in law, as most biological new ideas, mutations, are bad for us. It was that he respected the limits of knowledge. Justice Thomas, on the other hand, very much wants to go back and look at precedents and recast things. So my talk was describing the world as it seemed to Justice Scalia. He was much less willing than Justice Thomas is to go back and rethink. He wants to take the body of law as largely as it is. Some rethinking, but rethinking at the margins rather than thoroughgoing. And one can question whether that is good or bad, but that was how Justice Scalia thought.
Any other comments with respect to that question?
One other approach to the conundrum of the incorporation clause post-incorporation is to focus more intently on the vision of
the 14th Amendment itself, which after all, it was later in time, did amend the Constitution in a way that was directly relevant to the original Bill of Rights and focused less on what the framers of the original First Amendment said its words, more on what the framers and ratifiers of the 14th Amendment said and did in the process of making various rights, privileges, freedoms, and immunities applicable against states and localities in the sentence, "No state shall make or enforce any law which shall abridge the privileges or immunities of citizens of the United States."
I apologize. I apologize if my question was unclear. I didn't mean.
Oh no, I thought it was very clear.
No, but.
And so did the panelists.
But it wasn't. But I'm not sure Judge Easterbrook understood what I meant.
No, I think he did. Did you understand what he was asking, Judge Easterbrook?
I think so. But
okay. Well. Then I think we have closure. Thank you. We'll take the next question. And may the force be with you. All right.
Another,
right ahead.
Another timely question, Gary Lawson, Boston University School of Law. And for purposes of my question, assume that I'm wrong about stare decisis, because that makes this more interesting. I'll address this virtually to Judge Easterbrook, because it's got algebraic kinds of things in it, but it's actually addressed to John Harrison. All right, December 15th, 1791, Bill of Rights has been ratified. You read the Constitution correctly. And it instructs you to think X about rules and Y about standards. That's just stipulate that's the correct set of instructions you get. Fast forward 2 1/4 centuries to a world in which the doctrine is X minus N rules and Y plus N, M, O, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, whatever, standards. And that isn't going to change in any dramatic fashion. In that second T1 world, do you apply, in the context of a particular dispute, the rule orientation of December 15th, 1791, or do you have to do something different?
Algebra usually has an equal sign in the equation. And I was trying to visualize
X minus
and then
N
see
plus
how many equations I needed to solve it. But
okay, X minus N plus Y plus M equals crap. There's your equation.
No, I think
it's a second best problem.
Yeah, maybe I'm just hearing another version of the previous question, and maybe I'm just hearing it incorrectly. But it again sounds like a question to what, if you are a faint-hearted originalist like Justice Scalia, rather than somebody who wants to go back and rethink everything, what do you do? I mean, let me give you an example of this where I think Justice Scalia got it wrong. In McDonald against Chicago, the question arises whether the Second Amendment applies to the states. And 30 years ago, in a series of opinions during the Warren Court era, justices had said, well, we're going to apply those amendments that we like and not those amendments that we don't like. They didn't use that exact language, but that's what they meant. Over the possibility, which Justice Black had raised in his dissent in Adamson in 1947, that we go back and reconsider everything and figure out what the real meaning of the Privileges and Immunities Clause of the 14th Amendment is and overrule the slaughterhouse cases. McDonald arrives in the Supreme Court. Justice Thomas says, the slaughterhouse cases were wrongly decided. I would overrule them and apply all of the constitutional amendments to the states. To which the majority, joined by Justice Scalia, said roughly, oh my goodness, that would mean we'd have to apply the Seventh Amendment to the states, and who wants to do that? So for instrumental reasons, we are not reconsidering this terrible, terrible precedent. That's what a faint-hearted originalist does, but it is a modest approach to dealing with information. It was a very strange outcome in which a plurality of the Supreme Court applying the Second Amendment to the states channels Justice Brennan, and the liberal dissenters not wanting to apply the Second Amendment channel Justice Harlan, the second Justice Harlan. But that's where you get if you're not willing to sit down like Justice Thomas and really go back through the records and see where we should go.
And for the record on that one, I speak for myself as a liberal originalist. I'm with Justice Thomas.
Yeah. All right. Next question, please.
Hi, my name is Nick Rotz. I'm an attorney here in D.C. And I'd like the panel's take on how they think the APA can bind Congress in administrative agencies created after the APA's enactment. Thanks.
Same problem as a problem similar to the War Powers Resolution. I think the APA has succeeded in creating a structure that is generally assumed to exist, but I think the question is, has that actually happened? Probably yes for the APA, but it's a similar question.
Next question.
Good morning, Judge Mary DeGennaro, Ohio 7th District Court of Appeals. Listening to the panel debate, rule versus standard, so when you have language in the Fourth Amendment about reasonableness, and that's a standard, as I understand the position of the panel, does that in and of itself become a rule? So then when a judge is called upon to interpret a case involving whether a search is reasonable, are judges acting modestly because the rule is we need to consider what is reasonable? If that's a valid premise.
Thank you. Who'd like to tackle that?
Well, maybe I can say a few words about that. Fourth Amendment says, to give the briefest version, no unreasonable searches and seizures. And you then have a question I'm going to discuss it very briefly, a case from 1973. You then have a question about whether when you arrest somebody, you can search the things on him. So in this case, Robinson, they pull out a cigarette pack from the guy's pocket, and inside the cigarette pack, they find some unlawful drugs. The question is whether that is reasonable. And the Supreme Court wrote an opinion that said, trying to figure out whether something like that is reasonable case by case would just make a hash of things, because then no officer in the field would know what could be done. So although the constitutional reasonableness is a standard, but we have to make a standard work, and we think we have the right, in roughly common law fashion, to adopt either the rule of always search the stuff or never search the stuff. And we think always search the stuff is reasonable. I think that kind of common law completion of a standard by what looks like an operating rule is fairly common in American jurisprudence. And Justice Scalia was as much in favor of that as anybody else on the court.
Professor Amar.
So just to elaborate a little bit on the language of the Fourth Amendment, the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures shall not be violated. And then there's some rules about warrants. We can actually squeeze out from that text maybe some additional information. Why are persons and houses and papers singled out above everything else in the world, all the other stuff, effects? And we might say, well, because it says reasonable, but maybe it's also giving us some additional hints about certain things that are perhaps particularly important. Your person, your body, and ideas of bodily integrity. Your house as distinct from all other buildings in the world, because a house is a seat of domesticity and privacy in a way that a factory isn't, or a shop isn't. And indeed, the Third Amendment talks about houses as well in its rules about recording of troops. Papers are perhaps particularly important because First Amendment-like values are particularly at issue when searches and seizures occur of documents. And here we go back to Justice Scalia on, for example, handwritten letters. So Justice Scalia at his best actually was attentive to some of these things. There are other constitutional principles applicable when we understand that there are rules and standards about race discrimination and sex discrimination. I want to read you just one little passage from a couple of my favorite Justice Scalia opinions on the Fourth Amendment. This is a piece in which actually Justice Scalia writes for the court. And my former boss, Justice Breyer, writes in dissent, and I, in the end, say, you know, on this, you know, score one for Justice Scalia. I'm with Justice Scalia on that. And this was a case in which the police entered a dwelling place. They were supposed to wait 15 seconds after announcing their presence, which was knock on the door and wait. And they didn't, and they sort of burst in. They found a bunch of drugs, and Justice Scalia, this was an exclusionary rule case. And by the way, where does the Constitution say the exclusionary rule? It doesn't, and yet Justice Scalia never said we should get rid of it altogether, which I wish he had, and even Justice Thomas hasn't said that, but where's that coming from if we're serious about rules in the Constitution? But Justice Scalia, in an exclusionary rule case, said, listen, they didn't wait 15 seconds as they should have, but they would have found the drugs anyway 15 seconds later. There's no real causation here, kind of inevitable discovery. Why not admit the evidence? And then he actually explains, in effect, why we have this rule. The rule is not to get, why actually you should wait 15 seconds, why that's a component of Fourth Amendment reasonableness when people are entering dwelling places, houses which are singled out for special treatment above everything else in the world, along with persons and effects. He says it's not to give crooks 15 extra seconds to flush the stuff down the toilet. That's not the reason that you have 15 extra, there's a general proposition that it'd be reasonable you need to wait 15 seconds before barging into someone's home. It's to give, in effect, the lady of the house, the gentleman, a chance to cover up, you know, to put in, to get out of bed and put on a robe or something like that. The New York Times mocked Justice Scalia for this, in fact, but I think Justice Scalia got it just right, and here's what he said in a different case, very interesting. This is a case about using high-tech surveillance technology, kind of like ray gun that could detect thermal images within a house. Is that a search or seizure? Well, at the founding, who knows, but he applied the rules of the text with an idea to the larger purposes. He did at his best. And this case, the Kylo case, is one of his, I think, great opinions. And here's one of the reasons that he gave for treating this as a search. He says, using this thermal imaging technology, the government would be able to learn, quote, at what hour each night the lady of the house takes her daily sauna and bath. A detail that many would consider intimate. And here's what I write. I said, you know, this is not some personal obsession of Scalia's. The Fourth Amendment's framers had a remarkably similar view of the amendment's core rights and core remedies. This is a 1787 pamphlet that he didn't cite, but I think it really would have reinforced both of his opinions, both of which I think were correct in this Fourth Amendment domain. This is a 1787 anti-federalist pamphlet that says, if a constable searching, quote, for stolen goods, pulled down the clothes of a bed in which there was a woman and searched under her shift, A trial by civil jury would be our safest resource, and heavy damages would at once punish the offending constable and deter others from committing the same. Okay, if you just focus on reasonableness and isolation, maybe that's not going to help you very much, but if you focus on person and houses and papers and other constitutional values and see structure as well as text, we can actually make some progress.
Before we take the next question, that was S-H-I-F-T, shift. All right, yeah. Let's go.
Brian Bishop from the Stephen Hopkins Center for Civil Rights in Rhode Island. I wanted to ask because Judge Easterbrook gave us as a really preferential rule for preferring rules, the notion that similar cases would be decided similarly. But I wonder if the judge or the panel understands the concern that moves judicial discretion to whether cases are similar. And I think that many of us struggle, for instance, with whether Lopez and Raich were similar cases.
Thank you for the question. Judge?
I don't want to talk about any particular claims of similarity, but the style of interpretation that Justice Scalia is worried about, sometimes called balancing tests, and which I prefer to call chopped salad jurisprudence, is that the judge gives a list of things to be considered. And then we'll say, well, you know, I've considered this list, here's the outcome. Although the things on the list aren't comparable. It's not in one dimension. You can't perform algebra on it by adding, subtracting, multiplying, and dividing. And then in some future case, the judge will say, aha, but the last case had 8 factors and this one had 9. And it's true in the last case we didn't mention factor 9 and didn't try to figure out whether it was there or not. But therefore, this case is coming out differently. And the center of his attack in the rule of law as a law of rules was that kind of deciding in which there is nothing stable and in which the judge is deciding in some later case, completely independent of what the litigants want, of the need of society for some certainty in the legal framework, the judge is deciding, well, here's what's important to me, and it's true, I still can't compare it to the other 8 factors, and then the next case will have a 10th factor. I mean, to the extent judges have discretion, Justice Scalia was saying, you want to avoid that because, well, you want to protect the populace against the variousness of judges. That if you look at the American bench has people appointed at different times in different regions. They might have very different senses of what makes for a just or unjust outcome. But that's not a sensible way to run a large legal system. You have to have some way of producing some certainty. That's, I was trying to get across, in part, that idea for what judges do when they have discretion, but also to get across, in part, Justice Scalia's very strongly held view that, by and large, judges don't and shouldn't have discretion.
Rules have built into them criteria of what matters and what doesn't, and hence criteria of what is similar and dissimilar. And so, yes, you're right. One of the policy decisions a court makes in formulating and deciding what rule to formulate is precisely to choose those criteria.
Yeah, go ahead. Well, on a 9-factor test, these will operate, in fact, as Judge Easterbrook so eloquently discussed, standards can become rules, and each one of those 9 factors then can become rule-like. And then you've just multiplied, even if it is the amount of discretion, whether you call it a standard or a rule. I have often been struck by the lack of consistency between the distinction between standards and rules. But my problem with balancing and standards is that they're often sort of either multiplicative rules, in other words, adding up 9 rules as opposed to 1, which you'll multiply discretion that way. Or in balancing, I teach my students that, in fact, it's always a fake balance because what you do is intuitively, sorry to invoke algebra, but I went to Stanford, a school that hasn't been mentioned, to be an engineer, and in fact, balancing tests are false. One side of the equation is just made into 0, right? And the other one wins. So, you know, there are many reasons why you can actually find that rules and standards are not add to the discretion. I mean,
and And even rules have limited domain. To come back to Robinson, the case that held, when you arrest somebody, you can search packages he's carrying. The Robinson rule distinguishes. It says if you arrest somebody on probable cause, you can search the packages. If you're just stopping somebody for a Terry stop, you can't search the packages. What's the difference between stopping somebody on reasonable suspicion and stopping somebody on probable cause? It turns out that that has never been reduced to a rule. Justice Holmes said in the common law that he was confident that the reasonable person standard in tort law would ultimately be reduced to a rule, that that was a goal of the legal system, a very important one. And here we are 130 years later, and we're no closer to that goal.
And since you mentioned Gonzalez and Lopez, that's about the power of, both cases are about the power of Congress to regulate interstate commerce. There were only two justices, I believe, that were in the majority in both cases, Justice Scalia and Justice Kennedy. I'm with them. And here's the distinction. I think they were both rightly decided, and they were rightly decided once we understand the rule's language and purpose, the rule being the Constitution. In Lopez, the case about guns in schools, there was nothing particularly economic or commercial in a narrow sense about guns in schools, and there was no genuine interstate issue to be solved in Lopez. There was no spillover problem or anything else. In Gonzalez versus Raich, as Justice Scalia noted in an important concurrence, there really is an interstate and international, that was a case about marijuana, there really is an interstate international market in marijuana. It's economic and it's interstate and international. And yes, on the narrow facts of the case, the particular marijuana plants at issue may have never crossed any state line. They were homegrown and being used by prescription for medicinal purposes, or at least so a doctor said. But as a practical matter, the government might have been concerned that some doctors would overprescribe. Doctor Feel Good is the person to go to get yourself, you know, good prescription, and you'll get more plants than you really need. And just surprise, surprise, some of those will find their way onto a black market that is genuinely interstate and international, and it's a market, and it's interstate. And Justice Scalia's thought in that concurrence that that made it decisively different from Lopez, especially when added to the rules and the words of the Necessary and Proper Clause that allow Congress not merely to regulate interstate commerce itself, but to regulate things connected to it. This is like what John Harrison was talking about, the original package doctrine, sort of at what point you sort of cut off the house that Jack built argument about something that really is connected to interstate commerce. But I think he got it right in both cases. I myself think that Sebelius, the Affordable Care Act case, there used to be a law called Obamacare, you see, that Justice Scalia's approach in Raich actually argued for congressional power in that case. I thought he got Raich right and Lopez right. I'm not so sure about Sebelius. Thank you.
Had I gone to the Harvard of the West, I would have allowed you a follow-up, but I didn't. Next question.
Hi, Dan McLaughlin from Sidley Austin. A rule by its nature tends at least, to be fixed over time. A standard, as we've seen with the court's Eighth Amendment jurisprudence, for example, or Judge Easterbrook's example of the Sherman Act, a standard tends to evolve. Is the choice of a standard over a rule inherently a choice to have an evolving standard, or is, if not, how is there a principal distinction made between a fixed and an evolving standard?
It's a good question. I haven't thought about it.
Thank you for a good question that's not been thought of. Oh, yes, go ahead.
Again, if the characteristic of standards, I think rules are intrinsically fixed over time. If the characteristic of a standard is that it's transparent to the purpose may or may not be the sort of thing that necessarily adapts. But it might be, and I think most of the purposes we think of are like that, and so they have something of a dynamic character. But I don't think that's inherent in the idea of a purpose, and hence I don't think it's inherent in the idea of a standard.
Our next and last question before we go across the hall to buy lots of wonderful books.
Hi, my name is Jessica Laird, and I apologize, Your Honor, but I'm a 1L at Yale Law. And my question is for the panel in general. So assuming that the purpose of the 14th Amendment is corrective and at the same time the amendment is colorblind, I'm wondering what the constitutional difference ought to be between a plus and quota system for affirmative action programs.
Thank you for your question.
So I apologize once more, but there's an essay in this book that talks about pluses versus quota. Here's what
I'm increasing my percentage because of your multiple mentions.
Thank you, Judge. Here's what I said, because the older I've gotten, I used to mock Justice Powell's concurrence, very famous concurrence in Bakke that made this distinction. And the older I've gotten, the smarter he's become. And I'm trying always, as a legal interpreter, to be generous to the legal materials, which of course include binding Supreme Court cases, especially ones that have been reaffirmed over time, as has the Justice Powell's Bakke distinction, which becomes the Grutter rule, now reaffirmed in Fisher. Now, if this is all in violation of the clear meaning of a text of the Constitution, well, the text of the Constitution trumps precedent, but if the text can be understood in different ways, we might want to try to take precedent seriously. Here are a few reasons why pluses might be different from quotas. There are at least three different ways of thinking about it. One is a matter of individual fairness to the Alan Bakkes of the world, the dispreferred claimant. It's one thing to, in a quota, to say you're just not even eligible for certain seats. Another saying you're eligible for everything, but it will be an all things considered analysis in which race may factor in, as may the fact that someone is bilingual or plays the tuba or is a great a linebacker or comes from Kansas. So just as a matter of individual fairness to the Alan Bakkes of the world, maybe pluses are different from quotas as a matter of kind of due process and fair, a right to be fairly considered for every position, above and beyond equal protection. Second, from the point of view of the alleged beneficiaries of affirmative action, maybe people, for example, who look like me, you may create more stigma and backlash against the alleged, the claimed beneficiaries of a system if you have a quota-like system that treats racial considerations utterly different than everything else in the process, which is sort of put into an all things considered slightly black box in which you look at extracurriculars and whether someone's bilingual and whether they play the trombone when you need a trombone player for your orchestra and all the rest. When you treat race as utterly different, 16 slots in which race is different than whether you're an alumni kid, for example, and everything else, you actually are harming the alleged beneficiaries of affirmative action sort of more than if you don't. A third is a more, so from the point of view of Bakke, it might be different. From the point of view of the alleged beneficiary of affirmative action, might be different. From a societal point of view, Powell doesn't quite say this, and maybe there's a certain lack of candor in saying this, but quotas actually may create just lots more, a more racially polarized discourse, a more tribalistic discourse generally in the society. That's not sort of a narrow rights-based way of thinking about it from the point of view of Alan Bakke or the alleged beneficiary, but it may very well be, and there's some empirical evidence on this, when you start talking the language of quota, you're priming people in racial ways that actually contribute to a more highly racialized, balkanized, polarized politics that's basically, that serves us ill. So in effect, yeah, pluses are long-term quotas. Powell probably knew that, but he fuzzes it up a little bit. He hides behind a fig leaf But fig leaves sometimes have purposes. They perform useful functions. That's a sort of an old-fashioned idea, that idea about modesty, perhaps. But sometimes fig leaves are better than their absence.
Well, on that note, don't want to go further with those analogies. I would like you very much to please thank our distinguished panel.